your service today. We have the picnic out at Cutter Park, and everyone is invited to come out for that. And we're going to have a good time of fellowship and food together. If you have brought food with you, please don't leave it out in your car. Bring it into the kitchen so that it doesn't spoil before service is over. So if you have food out in your car, go out and grab that and bring it in and set it in the kitchen. And then you can grab it on your way back out over to Cutter Park. Then we have our next, I don't remember what our next, okay, here we go. I was like, I don't know where we're at. I didn't bring my cheat sheet with me. Saturday, the 9th of September, we're having a kids ministry meeting at 12:30 here at the church. So if anybody is in kids ministry at all, doing the bus, helping with check-in, working over in the nursery or in the kids side, if you could come out for that short meeting, that would be great. You can learn some things. And then right after that meeting at 2 o'clock at the church is our sisterhood meeting. And that will be over in the fellowship hall. So all of the ladies are invited to come out for that one. And then these are going really quick. Getting me through these. Awesome. Next Sunday after service will be the 101 class. And I believe Rob is teaching that next Sunday after service. So if you have not taken 101, there's a sign-up sheet in the back, and then that will be directly after service next Sunday. And then we have life groups that are resuming on September 17th on that Sunday night. So if you are wondering what life group is, you can see Rob or you can see Pastor. And if you want to know where to be, you know, hooked up in one of those, or you want to lead one of those, talk with one of them, and they will give you more information about that. Now, Sarah has an announcement about Children's Church, so you can listen to her.
Hi, guys. You know I'm not a public speaker. All right, so how many of you remember Camp Homestay? So the kids earned a lot of tickets, a lot more, just for participating or coming. And then each other Sunday, they get more tickets for participating, answering questions, just anything to get them involved. We give them little like raffle tickets or coins. And since Camp Homestay, they have like wiped our store. So we need more stuff. It could be anything from pencil erasers, cars, dragonflies. I mean, they are not picky. They like and enjoy anything. Whoopee cushions, yes, they enjoy those. But also, Miss Kara took our children's Bible. So we need more of those, if possible. Just anything. Kids like anything. So we put a different amount of, say the Bible's worth 200 tickets, or $200 worth. So just if you can bring anything, you can talk to me or Rose, and we can stock it in our store.
Amen. Good crowd this morning. Hope you all can stay for the picnic too. And if you didn't bring food, don't worry. My wife cooked enough for me and her and about 20 other people. So we just want to encourage everyone to stay and come to the picnic afterwards. Even if you have to leave right after you eat, that's not a problem. We just love to see you there. So it's over at Cutter Park and just be there. Amen? Good to see everyone here. There have been a lot of prayer requests. We're going to do that later on in the service. I want to make it a special time of prayer this morning. Just so many things come into us, just even this morning, and our hearts are concerned. But we'll share that in just a little bit. But right now, we want to take an offering, and then after the offering, we got a special kit on a skit from the Skitmen. We got some Skitmen back there, and they're going to do one on baggage. And I don't know what all it entails. But Matt and BJ are going to be entertaining us here in just a few moments. And I appreciate them and their willingness to be involved in the church in so many ways. That's good. I want to say a special thank you to all the guys who helped with the bus. Came up with the men's breakfast yesterday. And then we worked on putting the seats in the bus. Getting all the seats out. Drilled them in grinding them out, offloaded and put in all the new seats. All we can do is bolt them down now. We did a few of them, but not all of them. But it's coming together. The bus should be finished this week. Get the lettering on there, and we got a brand new bus. Amen. So, Lord's been so good to us. George got in contact with us out at the salvage yard way out in Fosterburg, and they gave us all the seats for $15 a piece. And lights, they just gave us the bulbs and the fans and the, all the other little things that cost you like 15 bucks for every little thing. And they just gave it to us free. So, no, they just take it. And so, we went and stripped the buses down out there and got what we wanted. You know, cost us very little to renovate the entire bus, so we thank the Lord for that. God has been so good. Enjoyed it. Worn out. It's been about a two-week project from painting it to getting it all done, but it looks nice. Take a look at it out there, and it's not quite complete yet, but we thank the Lord. And thank God for the wonderful guys that helped and labored with us. And I'm a taskmaster. Now you know why they call me Pharaoh in Africa. I go, push, and some stick with me, and some just said, I'm out of here. I can be project-oriented and get into something, but I appreciate, I've outworked George to death. I asked Bonnie this morning, do you still love me? And she said, yes. And I thought, oh, hallelujah. I thought, she'll never let George go with me again. I about killed him for 2 days out there. But appreciate all the help. Everybody just dug in, and it's a blessing to us. God's good. Amen?
Amen.
We appreciate everyone. We appreciate your giving. And we know you give us unto the Lord, and God blesses you. And we want to thank you for your giving over the years and all that we've been able to do here at Bethel. In reaching the world with the gospel, we sent a check off to Sierra Leone, sent a money gram off to Sierra Leone last week for $5,400. There was a complication there, and they couldn't receive it. We have to resend it. But that was what was in there for Sierra Leone, and we wanted to thank you for everyone that's helping with that great need there. And also, we think of the great need in Houston and all that's been going on in Texas. Our hearts have been heavy. I don't know if you've been watching the news all week. I just have been grabbing every little bit I can on my phone and on a little bit of the TV that we are able to get with it. And it's just heartrending to lose everything you have. Yet I've seen such a picture of faith coming out of Houston. So many people talking about the Lord and the goodness of God. And even the president calling for a day of prayer today for Houston and the devastation there. And I thank God for a president that is very faith conscious, and God is doing a work in his life. He's coming into this faith, and he's surrounded by a lot of good people, wonderful Christians that are ministering to him all the time. And I know he's not all the way there yet, and he's got a lot of flaws in his life and a lot of things that he gets me a little upset once in a while. But then he says something and does something that just thrills my heart. And I think, well, thank God he's strongly close to the Lord. Amen. We need to pray for our brethren, amen? Pray for our country. Pray for Houston. And he called this a national day today to pray for the needs of our country, especially down there. And so I want us to before we take the offering, to stand and pray for the United States and for our president and for Houston and the suffering that's going on down there. That God would just use this as something good and great to bring our country back together again. How many? We need each other. We need each other. We cannot be divided and separated by politics and all this nonsense. Let's pull it together, and let's just get a hold of God. Let God do a work in our midst. Amen? And I know God will bless us. Father, we look to you right now. Our hearts are heavy. Are heavy for our country, Lord, that's been so divided and so separated and so much anger, Lord, from the left and from the right, and trying to get these extreme parties together, Lord. It's just been a work of the devil to try to divide our nation. And Lord, we know your word says that a nation that's divided against itself cannot stand. And we know that's the will of the enemy, to divide and to destroy this wonderful nation called the United States of America, Lord. And so we look to you For you said that righteousness would exalt a nation, God. Righteousness would unite us. Righteousness would cleanse us. Righteousness, Lord, would exalt us and build us up and make us a great nation, Lord. It's not in arms and nuclear weapons and all of the forces that we'd have in our military that make us strong. But we know that we're strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. And so, Lord, we ask for your blessing upon our nation, God, and for your spirit to move all through Houston, God, in that area of Texas and Louisiana, the suffering and all that's going on in those areas, Lord. Minister to them by your spirit. Send the comforter to them. And Lord, let them draw their strength from you. And Lord, meet every need. Minister to them, Lord, through the sacrifices of so many that are sending and helping and doing so much, Lord, to meet the needs of those people and bring it together, God. Let things be restored speedily for the glory of God. And we'll thank you for it. We ask you to bless our president, Lord. We lift him up to you. God, though he has flaws in his life and he's not all that he needs to be, I pray, God, that you would continue to chisel away in his life. God, continue to do that work to make him a precious diamond used for the glory of God to make our nation strong again. Lord, we know you can do the impossibles. And so, Lord, we believe you for that. We ask you to do it, Lord, and bless America again. Bless America again. God, bless America. We'll praise you for it in Jesus' wonderful name. Now, Lord, we ask you to bless this offering that meet the needs of your people. Oh, Lord, let us give joyfully. Let us give generously. Let us give as unto the Lord. And bless this offering in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Now we're going to take up the offerings. We're going to have everybody shake hands and just come on up here and we're going to put the plates. Brother Dave, if you come up here, grab these plates, put them up here on the communion table. And we're just going to come and shake hands, bring your offering. Let's spend a little time with fellowship. Amen. Hallelujah.
Make sure my brother has his mic on.
After we take the offering, then we're going to have a speaker to play the letter.
Thank you.
bless you all. We needed that time, but yeah, well, the fellowship. I love to shake hands and just say hello to everybody. Sometimes they'll come in and leave, and I say, boy, I didn't even get to shake their hand. And I think I covered a lot of bases, not all, but most of them. I see a few I missed, but good to have you all. Good to have all of our visitors with us, too. Amen. Tammy's got family in, and I appreciate them all being here this morning. And then someone else was in the veterans that are here. God, I'm getting my mind moved up here, so God's good. At this time, we're going to have a special skit done. It's on baggage. I don't know all the details. Sometimes I get to preview it, sometimes I don't. So I'm going to turn it over to Matt, and he's going to fire away.
Yeah, we were best friends in kindergarten. I did, trust me. That's just Don't let this girl come between us.
No. You know what? I think Forever just got a lot shorter.
Really? Come on, man.
No. You did this. You're supposed to be my best friend. And our friends. They don't mean to hurt us. And they're just trying to get through life the same way we are. And we can choose, we can learn to forgive them, or we can collect more baggage. And, you know, the truth about baggage is we don't need other people to put it on us. We do a pretty good job at dumping it on ourselves. Like when we compare ourselves to others and we think something like, if I could be as good as they are, if I could be as gifted and talented as they are, but I can't. I'm no good. I'm a loser. And when we believe that, when we believe that, we collect more baggage. Or when we think something like, they've got it made. Why is life so easy for them and so hard for me? I'm never going to make it. And when we believe into that lie, what we do is we collect more baggage. And, you know, baggage, I mean, it's a lot of weight. And as we get older, we tend to collect baggage from people that mean the world to us and are very close to us, not realizing that their words cut like a knife.
Son?
Hey, David.
So what happened with that?
The ball slipped, the light got in my eyes.
The ball slipped?
Yeah.
You know that this calls this a game, right?
Yeah.
How many times did I wake up before 5, before I go to work, to go over these drills and stuff with you, and this is the outcome of it?
Dad, the ball slipped.
Right, the ball slipped.
Hey, Dave, what do you want me to do?
Hey, coach. Yeah, Butterfinger's over here. Yeah, we'll work with him, all right? See you later. Grab your stuff and meet me at the car.
Dad.
I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed. Okay? Grab your stuff and just meet me at the car.
Dad. And our parents, they don't mean to hurt us. It's just, they've got their own baggage. And the thing about baggage is, you don't deal with it. You pass it on. And if we let those words, get to us, what we do is, we collect more baggage. And, you know, it's tedious. It's uncomfortable. And our natural tendency is to want to dump this baggage onto someone else. But yet, it always seems to backfire.
Hey.
What are you doing in my room?
I just wanted to ask you a question.
What?
I was just going to see if you give me and my friends a ride to school. It's raining outside. What's so funny?
You're really asking that question?
Yeah, I just didn't think it was a big deal.
No. Here's something you need to learn. You know, when people look at you, they see a freak, okay? And if I take you to school, if they see me with you and they know we're brothers, people are going to start thinking I'm a freak too, okay? And I'm not okay with that. So I don't care how you get to school. I don't care whether you have to walk, crawl, whatever. But I'm not going to be a chauffeur for you and your loser friends, okay?
It's not my fault Dad left.
Whatever.
No, it's not whatever. You just keep taking it on me like I'm some guinea pig.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No, you're not sorry. You're just sorry that I was calling you out for it. I'll just go ride my bike.
Come on, I said I was sorry.
No, I'll just go ride my bike.
You've been our attempt to try and dump our baggage onto someone else. Inevitably, what we do is we collect more baggage. And then there's that one. My sin. My secret sin. And I got control of it. What am I kidding? Most of the time this has control of me. And this is how I live. But yet, I remember the words of Christ, because he said, I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly. I don't know about you, but this doesn't feel like abundant life to me. I mean, I can barely keep my balance. I can barely walk straight. But then, I remember, because Christ also said, come to me, all of you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's what I want. So I go to him, and I say, God, if you're willing, would you take this baggage from me? Because God, I can't live this way anymore. Please, take it! And you know what? He takes it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, speaking right now over his church. Not just this church, but the body of Christ as a whole. You know, it's time for us to surrender. To surrender everything that we have in our lives. And not to hold on to any bondages or any secret sins. God wants a holy people without condemnation, but a people because of his great love. He wants a body that is doing his will. Let us get rid of every bondage and every secret sin, and let the Holy Spirit come and burn in your life. Let him burn out the sin and put a passion in your heart for this last day move of God. Come forth, people of God. Rise up and take your place. Shake off secret sins and any bondage that might hold you bound. For the Lord is calling his people to put on the full armor of God and stand in this wicked day. If we are the church, a holy church, why would the world want to come and take part and participate in this place? Not that we don't have our faults and our shortcomings, because we do. And the Lord knows our frame. And he's so compassionate and full of mercy and grace. But he says, arise and take your place as the body of Christ, so that he can come back in those clouds and take a people that are holy and standing before him. That when we come to church, it's not a time to just sit down and to relax and get on our phones and do whatever we do, but it's a time to raise up a standard and give Almighty God praise that's due in the house of the Lord. It's a time to worship him and let his presence come in. And when people walk through those doors, they know that they have been in the presence of Almighty God. Because the shackles and the chains will be broken by the Holy Spirit. You know, God's given us that gift. If we're going to be called a Pentecostal people, that we pray in the Holy Ghost every day. When we're driving in the car, we're praying in tongues. When we go in the supermarket, we might be under our breath praying in tongues. You know, you can pray in tongues, you can sing in the Spirit, and you can move in the gifts of prophecy. You can move in the word of knowledge and in the spirit of wisdom.
Hallelujah.
And discernment from good and evil. And God will place in different churches these ministries, but you must hunger. You must thirst. When Mark and I first got saved, that's what we did. We spent days and nights on our face before God. We were brought from hell, from the pits of hell. I was raped when I was 16 years old with a gun in my head, and then I told him, just kill me. Well, suicide came after that. I began to try to kill myself, but you know what? God had a plan. God was merciful and he called us to be a holy people. And my heart's desire ever since I accepted Jesus Christ, I was a Catholic. No disrespect to anybody, but I did not know Jesus. I didn't know about his blood. I didn't know that he died on the cross for me. That he took me from the depths of hell, headed for hell, and set my feet on a solid rock. My foundation is strong because I believe in Jesus. Not that Mike and I are anything special, but we desire to be servants of the Most High God, to be used in any way that he chooses to use us. And young people, God's got a special plan for each and every one of you. Rise up and take your place. Ask God what he would have you to do. It may not be behind a pulpit. or a preaching ministry, but each and every one of you can tell someone about Jesus, of his love and his mercy. But if you're not living the life, they're not going to want to come near you or desire what you have. Let us rise up, church, and be the people of God. Jesus is weeping over his body. He desires for us to rise up in this day.
What a need in the church today, amen? And if God can't depend on the Pentecostal people, not that we're the only ones, and I believe in all the others that God is doing in their life, but I do believe in the fullness of the power of the Holy Spirit, to whom much is given, much is required. I'm telling you, Jesus said, don't go, don't do anything until you be endued with power from on high.
Yes.
We've been doing a whole series on the Holy Spirit and the moving of the Holy Spirit. And if you don't believe in that, then...